So the one that's of interest for us this morning and for our exercise, which will follow our presentations, is the one called GCI2.html. That stands for Georeferencing Calculator International Version 2. Now, the same software is available online, but we put it on the flash drives to minimize the traffic on the internet and to make sure that we had access to the calculator if we had internet access or not. So, is anyone having trouble finding the location of the georeferencing calculator folder? Yes? So, on the flash drive, there's a folder for data cleaning and data publishing. That's our workshop, everything for our workshops. Inside of that, there's a folder for software. Inside of the software folder is one for georeferencing calculator. And then within georeferencing calculator, there are many different files. The one that is of interest to us, the central one, is called GCI2.html. GCI2.html. If you open it, you should get something that looks like this. Question? The HTML part is hidden in your browser. You can see this one, it says Firefox HTML document. It's just that the HTML part is not showing, it's where your machine is set up. So look for the one that opens the calculator, it should look something like this.
You can see that little app that comes up, asking whether or not they want to run Java, so they should think to run.
Yes, if it's asking you if you want to run Java for this program, say yes. If it tells you you do not have Java, then we'll have to wait, because we can't solve that problem quickly right now. The important part for the moment is that this page has links to documents that I would like to refer to. The calculator itself is not important at this moment, but the links at the bottom are important. I'm going to proceed. I just want to make sure that you're in the process of getting the calculator functional. And I want to show you at the bottom of the calculator these three links. Basically, this page gives you access to all the fundamental information about georeferencing, including the original document in which these methods for the point radius were described. That's the link called Georeferencing Guidelines in the bottom of this page. See it right here, Georeferencing Guidelines. So if you click on that, you can open the page, which looks like this. So this page, this web page, which is also available on the MAMIS website, is the theoretical background for all the calculations that are made by the georeferencing calculator and also by the automated georeferencing tools such as Geolocate, BioGeomancer, and Geomancer. So if you want to understand the theory behind how the calculations are done, this is the document that you need. So we don't have time to go through all the theory in detail, but I want you to know that it exists. And in fact, once you get into georeferencing, even if you're using automated tools, what geolocation provides an answer, you should understand what those tools are doing to know when to trust them and when not to trust them. You shouldn't just take the output of those programs without a critical eye. Okay? Because they are making assumptions and they're doing things in the best way they can automatically. You need to understand what it is they're doing, how, what assumptions they're making. So this theoretical document tells you what those are. We'll be using this document in the exercise a little bit later, because at the bottom of this document, there are examples of different kinds of calculations. You can find those here in the table of contents. It says calculation examples. I'll show you later exactly what it is that we're going to do there. But basically, we want to try to replicate these examples using the calculator and see if we can get the same answers as this document tells us. Okay? So that's just a little bit of a preview of what it is we're going to try to achieve. Back to the calculator page, there are two other references on this page. There's a quick reference guide, and there's a calculator manual. The manual is straightforward. It's just telling you how to use this calculator. I'm not going to go through that document. It's there for your purposes. I'm going to demonstrate the calculator, which will cover the contents of that calculator manual. We're not going to go through the manual itself. However, I do want to show you the third document, the Georeferencing Quick Reference Guide. It's a PDF document which has its source, original source, in the HERPnet project. It was originally an Excel spreadsheet that attempted to describe exactly how you should treat different kinds of localities when you encounter them. By different kinds of localities, I mean, examples like these. One locality type consists only of a named place. So an example is Nairobi. It doesn't have any distances or directions or anything else. It's just a named place. So Nairobi falls into this category. This georeferencing quick reference guide explains to you how to do the calculations for the georeference for this case. So basically, this is a recipe of what to do in the georeferencing calculator if your locality is of this type, follows this pattern. So for Nairobi, what we would do is we'd pick a calculation type and calculate as a comparer only. We would pick a locality type, a name, place only, and then we would read this and do what it says. We'll actually do some of these in a moment. I wanted to let you know that this document exists to help you figure out how to proceed to do a georeference for different types of localities. The named place only, this one at the beginning, is the simplest possible kind. There are many others, and this document is color-coded to show you different types. So all those in blue up till now were named place only variations. Then we get into the next type, which is an offset. In other words, it has a direction component, like north of Nairobi. Now there's another type after that, which is coordinates only. Following that, one with more than one possibility. And there are problems. So I'm going to go through these different types in a little more detail so that you understand their components and where the uncertainties come from when we make calculations. The beginning of the georeferencing quick reference guide also gives you the Darwin core georeferencing terms. You can see those here. And defines them and explains them in a little bit more detail than is possible on the Darwin core website. So it tells you what is decimal latitude, longitude, and geodetic data. Tells you that this combination of three fields can give you a location on the surface of the Earth uniquely, and that you need all three of them, not just decimal latitude and longitude, to do so, to uniquely locate those on Earth. about the data. These latitudes and longitudes are basically equivalent to telling you that I weigh 180 without telling you the units. I weigh 180 pounds, 180 kilos, without telling you, you might not know. Guess by looking at me perhaps, but if I haven't told you, it's ambiguous. Without the data, the latitude and longitude are ambiguous. It's an important point. Okay, so because we have such limited time, you remember yesterday that I told you that normally we do a georeferencing workshop in 5 days. The minimum that we have done is in 2 days. So you're getting just a brief view of a small part of georeferencing. And I'm hoping that this small part gives you an idea of the importance and the complexity of this part of the process of data cleaning, data augmentation, and data quality. Remember, the point behind doing the georeferencing was to make the information more usable in the wider world. Okay, so first thing then, what I'll do is take a look at paper maps. we go through in detail what the contribution is from this source. The georeferencing calculator actually includes these calculations for you. So as long as you know the map scale, the georeferencing calculator can tell you what that uncertainty is from the map. Next and most obvious source of uncertainty is something that we saw yesterday in the presentation about the different methods of georeferencing, and that is the extent of the property. This is the small version of the picture of the point radius around the city of Davis in California. Remember that? So the extent is how far from the center of the place to the farthest reaches of the place. In other words, how big is the entity? How big, for example, is Nairobi, if we have a location that references Nairobi? So that contributes, usually that contributes a lot of uncertainty. The next source can be GPS accuracy. You can take a coordinate in the field with your GPS, but it's not perfect. It's not perfect because of the conditions and the limitations of the technology. Generally speaking, if conditions are normal, that there are sufficient satellites, and you're not in a location where the GPS signal is bouncing off of buildings, or off of trees, or off of cannon walls, this GPS accuracy is usually under 30 meters, many times much under 30 meters. The only way you can know GPS accuracy is to have the GPS tell you, because it's an attribute of the moment and the location. You actually have to read it off of the GPS. If you don't have the information, you know that the coordinates came from the GPS, we have to use our best estimate. And our best estimate these days is to use a 30-meter accuracy. If the GPS coordinates came from before the year 2000, when GPS accuracy had been obscured, the GPS accuracy we would say was 100 meters. But after 2000, all that obscuration of the GPS signal was removed, and the GPS accuracy was as good as it could be, and now we use 30 meters instead of 100 meters. The next source is the unknown data. A geodetic datum is a description, a mathematical description of the surface of the Earth. There are many, many different datums, more than 200 different datums in use in the world to describe the surface of the Earth. Why is that? Because when people make maps, they would like to describe the surface of the Earth in their location where the map is as well as they can. But there's no single datum that describes the whole surface of the Earth very well. And so each location, each country or region might have its own datum in order to best match the surface of the Earth in that area. More recently, there have been global datums that try to do as well as possible to cover the entire Earth. In other words, to average the inaccuracies over the surface of the Earth. And when you get a GPS these days, they come configured to the most popular of those worldwide datums. And that one is called WGS84. When you look at Google Maps or Google Earth, or just about any mapping program online, they are all using that WGS84 global data. The problem is, when we get coordinates, we actually are almost never told what the datum is. And if the coordinates came from a map, and the map is older than 1984, certainly that it was not WGS84. It was some other data. Which means the coordinates, if you put them on Google Maps or Google Earth, may not actually fall where you would expect them to be. They're offset because it was a different data used. So, because we don't know the data, there is a possibility that there's an uncertainty associated with it. And this is a map showing what that uncertainty is if you don't know the data in North America between two different possible datums. Just to give you an idea, were ranging in this part of the United States from no uncertainty at all, as exactly the same in both datums, out to Alaska or Hawaii, where we can actually get almost a half of a kilometer difference. When you talk about the whole world and all of the 200 different datums, the worst possible scenario in the entire Earth is 3.5 kilometers difference. So it can be serious. Having GPSs doesn't actually solve that problem necessarily. The reason is, if you have a researcher who goes all over the world and matches the GPS data to maps wherever he goes, he may come back and leave his GPS for you to use, but it's in a datum that doesn't match where you're going on your expedition. And so when you get there and you start recording points, they're for some other location in the world, and if you don't know the data in use, the points will end up in the wrong place. Okay. So I'm sort of beating this one over the head because it's something that people don't realize, and yet it's everyday problem. It's an everyday problem that they believe that technology is solving for them with having GPSs. You have to be careful that they actually be creating more of a problem than you need. So unknown datums can contribute up to 3.5 kilometers of uncertainty. Very serious problem, a very tragic problem, really, because it can be avoided. Now, we have imprecisions that arise from particular kinds of locality descriptions. We have imprecisions in direction measurements. That is, you have a location that describes a place that is north of, use the example north of Nairobi. This is where I want to make a drawing. There's a contribution to the uncertainty of not knowing what north means.